Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Welcome to the next session. On end-user programming and mobile devices. So these are two interesting topics that we are trying to connect here. My name is Nikolai Tillman. I'm in Microsoft Research, in the Research and Software Engineering Group. And I will guide you through the session. So I will give you a brief introduction of our view on this problem area, or the challenges and opportunities that come with it. And then I'm very excited to have two professors, Christoph Sallner and Suresh Lota from UT Arlington and UC Santa Cruz, who will talk about their work on top of our platform that we built. So I'm sure you are all aware that mobile is exploding. Why does it matter to us? Why should we rethink the ways we teach software engineering, teach computer science? Why does it matter in the way how we program computers? So what's really new in this trend is that for the first time ever, if you wait a few more years, every person on Earth, pretty much, will have a computer. It's not a PC, it's a mobile device most likely. And it's probably going to be internet connected and very, very powerful. So we have many users connected to the cloud and with a computing device in their pocket at all times. This is a new development that we didn't have with a PC. We have now the case that, or it will be the case that every person has a computer. And these computers, they are tiny devices, smartphones. They are more powerful and equipped with sensors than any other computing device that we used to interact with. So not only are more people having computing devices, but these computing devices have many more sensors that have not been present in the past. So it starts with touch screens, that's a different way to interact with the device, but it also has cameras, not just one, but two. It's always connected to the cloud in many different ways, and we know it can where the location of the device is, how fast it's moving. This is a new reality that is dramatically different from what we had with a stationary PC. But at the same time, something else happened. A disconnect between the users of those computing devices and the way they are programmed. So the end users, they run applications that have been created for them, and applications are being created on a different platform in traditional ways that haven't changed much during the last decades. And there's a disconnect. Why do we need one computer to program a different computer? Why do we not give the billions of people who will have computing devices in their pockets the chance to actually modify the behavior of their devices? So we want, in our research group, we wanted to explore the idea of giving every end user the possibility to customize their device and create little apps from their ideas. So we created an environment called TouchDevelop, which is a integrated development environment that runs on a phone. So every end user, basically in a few years, every person on Earth with a smartphone in their pocket has the ability to compose new behaviors on their phone using this environment. So what we try to create is an environment that is really natural to the phone. Of course, you could just run a text editor on a phone and a little compiler and write C++ code, but that is basically how things used to be. with a disconnect. That's not how it should be. If you take this as a computing device in its own respect, then it needs its own user interface, not just to surf the internet, but also to write programs. We need a new way to write programs on these small devices. And that's what we try to achieve with this IDE. So the whole idea is that many, many people will have these phones, and maybe they don't even have a PC. And still, they should be able to write programs without ever touching a PC. So if this didn't quite make sense to you, I want to give you a demo how that actually works. So this should be a different PC. Do you get a picture from number four? I think it worked a moment ago.
PC4.
Yeah, I think it was PC4. Oh. Okay. We overcame the PC problem. They are complicated devices, right? Whereas with a mobile device, the experience is it just works, right? Of course. So what you see here is the home screen of our IDE, and I want to write a little script with you and to show you how the experience can be, how we can customize our mobile devices or make them do things they couldn't do out of the box and no app in the App Store or Marketplace did it in the way you wanted it to do. So I can create a new script. And what you see here now is a project system with a main function. I can define event handlers, and there can be global data. So there's a structure to how the program is entered, which makes it easier to write them and prevents certain kinds of mistakes. You can define abstract data types with records. You can include sounds and pictures. And there's a library concept to create modular programs. So let's go to the main function and write some code. What you see here is our default program that doesn't do much. It just takes a string and posts it to the wall. The wall is our notion of output. Our programming language has been adapted to the new century, millennium. We're living in the Facebook age. So wall is like the console, but it's more fun. You can have event handlers, colors, buttons. So what's really new about TouchDevelop isn't so much the language. This is a traditional procedural imperative language. What is new is how you edit it. Because there is no keyboard with 100 keys here. And our finger is really big. The resolution of the screen is amazing, but our finger is pretty big. So what we did is we studied in detail many different ways how we could edit structured code on a smartphone screen. And so we came up with a layered approach, a semi-structured editor. So at this level, I can only select an entire statement. And then big buttons appear that I can press with my finger to make the program do different things. I can say edit to edit the statement, because before, I couldn't select individual characters, but just the entire statement. Now the statement gets blown up, and I can actually tap on tokens. Again, not characters, they're still somewhat smallish, but tokens. And everything now at this level is at a token level. Let me do something else with a string instead of just posting it to the wall. It's a typed language. We found that very important to give good auto-completion suggestions. So at the bottom, you see different buttons that show what makes sense in the current context. These are different things I can do on a string. For example, I could try to make it to lowercase. That is a function available on strings. The buttons in the lower half, they adapt over time to the programs you write. We have very little space, so we need to try to get the best out of it. In some sense, what we try to create here is a domain-specific keyboard to enter code on a mobile device, right? These buttons are all specialized. You don't want a regular keyboard. You want a dedicated keyboard, a specialized keyboard for code. Okay, now I have a string. I turn it to lowercase, and let's post it to the wall. Another thing you see here, since it's a structured editor, we can play some games with the presentation. We have limited space, so there's an ellipse after the string because we abbreviated the string. So let's see what this program actually prints. When I go back to the main screen, here's the program, and now I can run it. There's a big run button to give instant feedback. No need to upload the program from a PC to an emulator or a phone. It just runs. So here you see the full screen. Now TouchDevelop is cool. And let's do this 10 times in a loop. So when I select a statement, I can add more statements. And here you see all the typical control flow that you're used to. Everything you know from Java or C# is available. So let's do a for loop. And now you see that I don't have to type all the details. I'm just filling in holes. So it's a structured editor. And we try to reduce her typing to an absolute minimum. Local variables are automatically synthesized. So I don't have to say that the loop variable is I. I could rename it, but I don't have to. And let's move this post to wall into the loop. I can cut it here. There's a cut. And I can paste it in here. Paste. And now I run it. 10 times. 10 times is cool. So you couldn't have done that faster in Visual Studio. So we really try to create an experience which is natural to the phone and which makes you just as efficient on the phone as on a PC. So I could keep programming forever and show you all of the other things that we can do. But I'm very happy that I think we are going to see later some examples of what students have written in this environment by Suresh Loda. So going back now to my slides. Okay. The group of Christopher Scafidi from Oregon State University, so he and his students, they analyzed what kind of scripts people write in our environment. So the TouchDevelop environment has been available now for a year. And people have been writing scripts, and there's a mechanism to share scripts, to publish them. And so many scripts have been published already. So they analyzed what are people actually doing on their mobile devices? How do they use such an environment to customize it? And they found some interesting results. So this is still ongoing, the investigation. So there's an equal split between utilities and fun, like games. So we see that many games are implemented. We really try to make it easy. There's a physics engine and graphics to create games. But we also see many utilities to turn on and off wireless internet or to make phone calls. So we have seen many interesting utilities. We also see that there is a third, roughly, of the scripts that have no apparent function. That's a bit funny. This is basically people who did a tutorial. The script doesn't do anything beyond the tutorial. Or the script is inherently broken. So this is evidence that people are just experimenting. We are seeing that many end users who might have never written a program in their life before are now trying with TouchDevelop to create a program. It's like a game. There's a tutorial built in. You have to tap, 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 and then something happens. So we are very excited to see that many people are trying out programming for the first time in their life in this environment. Another interesting insight was that there's a rather low rate of code reuse. So most of the time, once people get beyond the basic tutorial, they're trying unique ideas. it is not just tweaking little things, but we see many unique scripts being written. So if you go to our website, you can actually see the whole breadth of scripts that there are. You can upload screenshots. So here you see you can have fun with math. You can have many different games and other utilities. You can show maps and create directions. So overall, we have more than 6,000 scripts that people submitted to our script bazaar. So what comes together here is a new programming experience. We really try to reach end users out there who have gotten used to a certain way of interacting with a mobile device. So more people than ever are using mobile devices, and they're using it in all possible locations because they always have them with them. So we believe that we really need a language that is somewhat specialized for the phone, for the form factor. It's very tricky to write JavaScript code on a phone. Every language was designed for a particular purpose, and in the same way, we think that end users on mobile devices need to use a different language than all of the other languages out there. We also try to create a social experience that everyone is used to on a phone. You log in, you see your friends, you share what you are doing. It's a community. We believe that it's great for teaching. So just as the way humans interact with computers is changing because everyone is now having a mobile device, teaching computer science or programming should also use those devices for exercises. Otherwise, if you put a PC in front of a student, in a couple of years, maybe they don't take you serious anymore. So this holds for introductory courses as well as for advanced courses. So we created a book that explains all of the basic concepts. You can download it for free on our website. And there's also a set of slide decks. Now you might wonder, this is all great, but what does it run on? Does it run on Android, iPhone? No, it runs on Windows Phone. Surprise. So it's a free app for Windows Phone. All you need is a Windows Phone. Maybe you don't have a Windows Phone yet. And then we have good news that we can make available to you a set of phones for a classroom for a semester so that you can try it out if you're interested in teaching. And what is really exciting, I think, for students, at the end, the students created scripts, and many scripts resemble fully featured games that you find today on the marketplace. So what the students can then do, or you can take the script and sell it on the marketplace for money. So there's the experience begins programming on the phone to actually redistributing apps to other end users on their phones. So this is a whole new world, I believe, of programming on mobile devices. It used to be that we programmed on PCs, and we moved to laptops. And if you don't need a laptop anymore to program certain tasks, I truly believe that people will not use a laptop anymore. If you can do something on a mobile device while you're sitting in a bus, people will do it. So really embracing this new reality brings new opportunities for teaching and for research. So teaching in introductory classes, because mobile devices is what students know. That's what they will grow up with if you look at the next generation. And also for advanced courses, because it's so much easier to actually get started. You don't need first to worry about XML gluing codes and big IDEs with 1,000 buttons. It's much easier to get started and actually look at the relevant aspects of mobile devices, all the sensors, being mobile, cloud connected. And there are many research opportunities. We came up with one language and one user interface. Is this what I just showed you really the best possible one? I don't know. We are always trying to improve it, and maybe you have more ideas. By making it really, really easy to create scripts and share them with other people, we are also creating many problems. Because in some sense, there's a reason why many platforms only allow you to run curated applications that you download from a very special store. It adds a layer of security. And if you make it very easy to exchange programs that can do many different things, anything the phone allows you to do, then we potentially create privacy concerns. So that is an interesting area. We have some ideas and we have implemented them, but more work needs to be done. Another very exciting topic that we are currently working on is to allow distributed state. So it's very typical nowadays that you can share whatever data you create, whatever content you create with other people. But if you want to program such an app today, it's very tedious. You need to run your own web server. You need to worry about synchronization. So we want to make all of that very easy in an upcoming version of our environment. And with that, Christoph, can you come up? If you have any questions about this portion of the introduction, then I think we have some time to ask now. Yeah?
So first of all, the site seems to be down at the moment. But also, when you say research, is there the opportunity to develop new interfaces in your platform? I mean, can we try new? Is there an API to the editor or anything like that?
You want to change the editor?
Yeah, things like that.
So to change the editor, you would have to run code on the platform that was not certified by the marketplace. So that is not allowed. But as a university, we can give you a license to the source code so that you can make modifications and try out different things. That's what we want to do. We want to engage with anyone who wants to do research on this platform.
So have you done that, or is that an opportunity for the future?
We can today create a license agreement between you and Microsoft Research to give you access to the source code. We have different such license agreements on the way already.
Cool.
Okay. You can always ask questions later. So please welcome Christoph Sallner. He is an assistant professor at University of Texas in Arlington. Yep. I know Christoph from a long time ago when he was actually an intern at Microsoft Research. And so his research interests are in software engineering, particular around testing, data structure repair, and reverse engineering. Christoph Sallner got his PhD at Georgia Tech. So please go ahead.
Okay. So can you hear me too? Is my microphone on? No. I mean, it says on. It's on, okay. All right, so F5, I guess. Forward. Cool animations. All right, so I'm gonna talk about an experiment that we did to compare this new style of application development to the more traditional style of application development that you used to. And before I get started, I would like to thank my collaborators, Tony, you see the picture on the top, and Shaker, who cannot be here today, but did most of the work that I'm going to present, and they're with me at the University of Texas at Arlington. Okay, so what Nikolai just showed us is this new style of application development that revolves completely around the phone, where you edit code on the phone and then you run the code on the phone as well. So contrast that with the traditional approach to mobile application development. So there you use a traditional IDE like, for example, Eclipse or Visual Studio, and then you type and edit your code there. And once you think you're done, then you can try it out on an emulator. An emulator is essentially another application that runs on your desktop computer, which simulates how the phone will behave. And it will also simulate how your application will behave on top of that phone. So you can run your application on that emulator, and then once you find a bug or want to add some features, then you go back to your IDE. And basically, you do everything on your desktop computer. So there's this kind of an exception to that. You can also attach your actual mobile phone and then download your binaries into that phone and then run your application there. But if you want to go back to editing, then you have to go back to your standard IDE and do your coding over there. So despite these very different kinds of programming approaches, the resulting applications can look very similar. So here have a few screenshots that students wrote. It's a very small application that converts degree from Fahrenheit to Celsius. And left is TouchDevelop and right is Android. And you see that you know they look really very similar. So since TouchDevelop is such a new approach, we are curious, first, how people are using it so far, and then how, for a given task, the resulting applications differ between that new approach and a more traditional approach, such as Android development. So I'm using Android here just as an example. If you program for iOS or for Windows Phone, then you'll have a similar experience. You also have this big IDEs and emulators and all this stuff. So Android is just an example. Okay, so a little bit more concretely, there are three research questions we looked at. And the first research question is, how large are the applications that people have written so far in TouchDevelop? So what do you think, how large are the applications? Do you think, by show of hands, they're around 20 lines of code, mostly? Who thinks they're around 20 lines of code? One person. How about 50 lines of code on average? Okay. How about 100 lines? Still a few? 1,000? Some people? Okay, cool. All right, so what we expected is that you only have this very tiny screen and no mouse, no keyboard, so you would end up with very small applications. Oops, sorry. A second research question, for a given task, how does the size of an application compare between TouchDevelop and Android? Who thinks that a TouchDevelop application will be smaller than an Android application? Okay. How about the other way? Android application smaller than a TouchDevelop application? Nobody. Right, so from the screenshots and from the coding that Nikolai has done, I guess you've seen already that TouchDevelop is a quite focused language, so you don't see much of that boilerplate like import statements, variable declarations, etc. So we expected that TouchDevelop will be a small application than a comparing Android application. And finally, the last research question, maybe most interesting, is about the productivity. So what do you think? Is a TouchDevelop programmer more productive than an Android programmer? Who thinks TouchDevelop will be more productive? Few people. Who thinks that Android programmers are going to be more productive in coding? Right. Half. Right. So again, small screen, no mouse, no keyboard. So our expectation was that actually Android developers would be more productive than TouchDevelop developers. So to explore these questions, we had two kinds of studies. So the first one, we just downloaded all the applications that are in the cloud. So Nikola is providing APIs for that. We can just go and download all the code. In TouchDevelop, so people can publish lots of intermediate versions of their applications. And then we did a bit of data cleaning to only end up with the latest version of every application and kept those. And then we also needed some kind of metric to count the size of applications. And there are multiple metrics you can choose from, right? And since you also later compare TouchDevelop with Android, we picked a metric that seemed fair to both of them. So we settled for LSS, or logical source statements. It's just some scheme that counts the different kinds of statements that you see in source code. And for example, if you have some statement is a little longer, so and you have a small screen and it wraps around, then we will still count it as one statement and not two lines of code, just to be fair between TouchDevelop and Android. And then if you're an Android programmer, then you know that there are multiple different kinds of files that you have to worry about. There are multiple configuration files, XML files, text files, etc. And we, for simplicity, we just ignore all of those. Some of them can be generated automatically, but you still have to worry about them in Android programming. To explore the second and third research question, we conducted a small controlled experiment on student subjects. So I'm teaching a software engineering class, and there's a big group project as part of the class. One of the constraints is that this project is in Android. Okay, so from that class, we recruited 27 students, and they were all master students. So this experiment happened towards the end of the class, where we expected that people already had some Android experience because of this ongoing class project. And we got 10 phones from Microsoft, so at this point, thanks to Microsoft Research Connections. And we had a lab in university where we had plenty of modern PCs, so we could randomly assign students to the phones and to the PCs. Then we took one class period, 10 minutes for informed consent form, 60 minutes for students to work on tasks, and then finally 10 minutes for questionnaire. So you wanted to simulate individual development, so students were not allowed to talk to each other, and we also stressed that participating would not influence grades. A little bit more on the mechanics on that experiment. So the TouchDevelop crowd, they did not get any training in TouchDevelop. We just sent out links to a two-minute video on TouchDevelop on the TouchDevelop webpage and the API. And also, the TouchDevelop people were not allowed to use any other devices. So we wanted to simulate the intended usage of TouchDevelop, which is just on the phone, nothing else. And students spent about 5 minutes setting up the devices, like downloading TouchDevelop, installing, and download the Android tools. And both of these approaches come with Hello World kind of samples. So TouchDevelop has a bunch of samples, and Android has a wizard that can generate a Hello World program. OK, so at the end, the TouchDevelop cloud keeps saving everything that people are doing. So we didn't have to worry about that. But on the Android side, students had to email us their solutions. And two students failed to do that, so that reduced our number from 215 Android students. Okay, so in the questionnaires, we asked for the amount of prior experience that students had in the different approaches, and what we got was that, as expected, students had almost no experience in TouchDevelop, but some experience in Android. So here I have a plot of the time they claim they've spent to learn a technique. So in hours, a logarithmic scale, and then three groups of columns. The left group shows the number of hours that student said that they would have spent on TouchDevelop, and the median value is zero. The second group shows prior experience in Android, and the median value there was 30. And the rightmost columns show median prior experience in Eclipse, because Eclipse is a powerful IDE for Java and Android development, and many students use that. And I show two columns each because separate for the TouchDevelop people and the Android people. And since learning to program is well done by actually programming, I also asked for a number of lines written in one of the languages. And here we get the same picture that people had almost no TouchDevelop experience and a bit of Android experience. So the median lines of code written in TouchDevelop was zero. In Java was 250, I mean, Android was 250, and in Java, 1,000. Right, so Android is essentially Java, so that's why I asked for those two here. Okay, and here's the list of tasks that we gave to students. It's 11 tasks, they're all very small because they only had an hour of time. And they tried to be fair to both approaches, so every task can be solved in each approach. And also, they don't try to favor one of them. So we try to stay away from things that are especially easy in one of the techniques. For example, in TouchDevelop, it's very easy to access GPS location. So there's no task that uses GPS data here. So it just tries to do some general computing kind of very basic tasks. For example, this Hello World application, which should be very easy because the approach already, there are already samples that students just have to change. And then this temperature conversion thing and then a bunch of other things. Okay, so here are the results for the first question, which was how large applications that people have written worldwide so far in TouchDevelop. And the result is that they are mostly tiny. Okay, so on the y-axis here, I have number of applications, sorry. And then they're ordered by size. So the left ones are the tiny ones, and then it increases to the what's the right. And every dot is represents a bin of applications within 5 lines of code. So the left dot is 0 to 4 lines. And the next one is 5 to 9 lines. And if you take those together, then we see that almost 50% of the touch develop applications so far are between 0 and 9 lines. And then the next two together, the first four are 60% is between 0 and 19 lines. The largest one we've seen was around 1,700 lines of code. So it's as of February. I'm not sure if your 6,000 number includes also prior versions or also. Okay, so we filtered out all the prior versions. So we only show the latest version that was in the cloud. So it was as expected. For the second task, comparing the size of applications for a given task, the result were also as expected that TouchDevelop applications were smaller than Android applications. So here's lines of code on the y-axis and all the tasks for which we received a correct solution on the x-axis. And then TouchDevelop TD is bold, dark, and Android is light colors. So you see that for every task for which we received correct solutions, the size of a TouchDevelop solution was quite a bit smaller than a correct Android solution, roughly by a factor of 4. So possible reasons for that size difference is that TouchDevelop is just a more specialized language that's more focused on the task at hand. There's less boilerplate code to worry about. It just leads to small applications. So if you have a task that can be handled in TouchDevelop, then it seems, at least for our tasks, lead to small applications. So you have a concrete example from this temperature conversion task, and the both correct solutions are on left-hand TouchDevelop, which is just a handful of lines, and on the right-hand side is an Android solution, so it's quite a bit larger. And finally, our results for the last question, which asked to compare the programmer productivity between TouchDevelop and Android programmers. Our result surprised us because in our experiment, the productivity of the TouchDevelop people was actually higher than the productivity of the Android crowd, which is summarized in this table on top, both in terms of number of tasks that people started and finished correctly. So on average, from the TouchDevelop people, they produced 2.4 correct applications, and the Android people only 1.7. And the plot breaks it out for the different tasks, and there also we see that for every task, the percentage of correct TouchDevelop solutions was higher than Android solutions. So there's several possible reasons for that, and it's just guesses here, but that's what we think contributed to that higher productivity is first there, TouchDevelop is a language that's more focused, so you can just deal with the task at hand, don't have to worry about all the boilerplate. And TouchDevelop has just features of modern programming languages that are not in Java, like type inference. So you don't have to write down the type of a local variable because TouchDevelop infers it. So it might be useful for small tasks. And finally, this semi-structured IDE. So it looks very nice. And so I'm wondering why we don't have that in regular programming. So why does Visual Studio not have that? And I would also like to have it in Eclipse when I program in Java. That might also help there. OK, so every kind of such experiments on human subjects has limitations, right? So, and our study is certainly no exception here. So we want to talk a little bit about threshold validity. So the first one is that our subjects were not a random sample of the intended target audience of TouchDevelop, which is hobby programmers and beginning students worldwide. So we just picked this bunch of students at UTA. And also there was a bit of self-selection because all the students subscribed to that course and they knew that it's going to be about Android programming. And then we also just told them, so here are 11 tasks and 1 hour, do whatever you want. Instead, we could have said, here are time slots, and in every time slot, you can only work on a certain task. But we feel that the way we did that represents more the typical development style where people work on something, then they learn something and come back to fix up some older tasks. And maybe most interestingly, the last point, we don't know how that generalizes to larger programs. And so what happens if you get to hundreds of lines, thousands of lines? At some point, this lack of big screen, mouse, keyboard might become serious and Android or traditional development might become more productive, but we don't know if that's true and where the crossover happens. Okay, to conclude, so what we've seen is that so far people have written small application touch develop. Then we conducted this controlled study, and in our study we found that applications were smaller in touch develop than Android, and also the productivity of the touch develop crowd was higher than of the Android crowd, despite having the touch develop people having less experience than the Android people. And there's lots of things we can do for future work. So first we could study where's this productivity coming from exactly. So there are several factors we could look at individually, like type inference and the semi-structured IDE. What happens for larger programs where we just don't know. And then there are several other software engineering tasks that we can study, like, for example, maintenance. So what happens if you give students a touch develop program and then ask them to add a small feature? Are they going to be more productive than corresponding Android people or less productive? And also, how do you do testing on a phone? How do you do debugging? You might need some new UI elements for that. All right, so that's a reference. There's a paper we published in the user workshop. And also, we have a web page where we collect a bunch of things you can download. For example, there's a corpus of all the TouchDevelop applications that we downloaded. And then the tools we built and the questionnaires, solutions, et cetera. All right, with that, if you have any questions, question. Right.
Why not touch develop to C-sharp in Visual Studio?
It would be the same framework.
I need you to say it in there.
Because you are venturing into another framework, right?
Right. I mean, one reason is practical, because the course just always does Android, so it just was easy for us. And the other one, I didn't understand that question with C++, C-sharp, because, I mean, in touch develop, you write in this touch develop language, and in C++, you write in C++, so.
So maybe, one more insight. So the TouchDevelop language also exposes its own APIs for all the sensors. This is not just passing through to .NET functions, but we have our own surface area. Mm. So it's not at all similar to .NET C-sharp development.
I see. The other question is your questions. You had 11 tasks. It seemed that
right.
A lot of them are very related. Are you testing code reuse here or?
No.
No?
Okay, yeah, but you're right. They're related, yeah.
They're very related.
Yes. And they're also, they're related. And Android, more experienced Android people, they reuse the code.
Maybe also in touch develop, because you already developed, maybe you take a lot of time in the first one, and then less time in the second one, and then you reuse. So you already have this data, by the way.
It seemed like that the touch develop students did not do so much reuse, though. The experienced Android people, they did reuse. They just, that's what they did, but not the touch developer people.
I think. Yeah. Thank you.
All right, should I?
Hello.
Okay.
I have the microphone.
Yeah.
I have two questions also. The first is just maybe a consensus or something. I saw in one of your slides that it said that people were taking more time learning Eclipse than learning Android. And my experience as a user of software development tools and languages is that the language and the APIs take a lot of time, and that Eclipse, once you get used to the sequence of clicks that you usually go through, is not that bad. Is that I'm astounded to see how difficult it is in reports like this for people to learn Eclipse. I'm wondering if you have any comments about it, or if anyone else in the room has comments about that.
One possible reason might be that the students misinterpreted the question and thought how much time they spent just working in Eclipse, and they had some Java projects they worked on as well. So that's one possible reason. Beyond that, I'm not sure how to answer.
Okay, so my other point is completely different. It looks like one of the things you're doing here, which I think is really good, is from an abstract point of view, starting at the root of the grammar tree of whatever language it is, of the touch develop language, and then having people fill in the details by touching various objects on the screen, working their way to the leaves of the tree so that they have a complete program. I saw some project that did this years ago in Pascal, when Pascal was big. And I just love the idea. And I'm wondering if anyone else has, or if you have any pointers or references to more recent work, aside possibly from TouchDevelop, that does that, say, for other languages and other platforms.
I'm not aware of that, but maybe that's really a question for Nikolai, because he's the TouchDevelop.
So I'm not aware that it's done for existing languages. I mean, there are specialized languages like the Scratch environment where it's being done. I think you do want to have a specialized editor for a specialized language. So that's probably a reason why it's not being applied more to existing languages. It's just not a good fit. Or not the best possible fit.
So
maybe one more question now?
Yeah, so I agree that it's there have been past interfaces for... Okay, there have been past interfaces for doing that sort of thing. I mean, it dates back to, you know, the Cornell program synthesizer and that sort of work. So certainly such things are in existence. I think they haven't been very popular recently. And I think it's nice to see those ideas rekindled in this environment. I think it fits the phone environment really well, where there's very little space. So that's nice. Yeah. I wanted to ask, though, about the measure of size. So I've studied programming languages a long time. And size in number of characters or lines of an artifact is not a really good measure of its cognitive complexity or the difficulty to understand it. And I was wondering if maybe there was a better way to compare size. So in the Android examples you showed, there were an awful lot of lines there that are part of a template. And the template ones really should not count. And I was wondering how you chose to count the lines. I mean, if to make an Android app, you start with this template and then you fill in some things, which is the standard way, then maybe what you fill in is what you should be counting.
Yeah, I see your point. So what we really counted was statements, not lines, but they're very similar, right?
Yeah, but even so, number of statements is not a, if you're counting the template statements, is still not a great measure of the effort you put into to crafting the solution.
Right. I mean, I see your point. Still, students can be confused about what all these statements mean and where should be changing something. So there's just more possibilities for making errors. So that was one motivation for using this logical source statements.
Okay, one very last question.
Oh, all right.
Yeah, this one right here. Sorry.
Oh. All right. You know, I just finished teaching close to 150 students a course where we use Android. So the course was about software design and data structures. So by the way, Eli Tillovich, Virginia Tech. You know, and I can attest to that most of our students, you know, they spend a large majority of their time trying to figure out different kind of idiosyncrasies of the Android IDE, basically, and the API, rather than focusing on software design and data structures. So, but my question to you is, what are your thoughts about, you know, teaching TouchDevelop, you know, as the first language? You know, because you know, the first language, you know, can have a tremendous impact on the programmer's cognition. Right, and we have to be responsible, basically, in what we're introducing our students first. So based on your experiences, do you think it's a good idea?
So I didn't really teach TouchDevelop, right?
Yeah, but I mean, if we were.
In training, right?
I think this is a great question, and our next speaker will answer it.
Oh.
So let's welcome Suresh Lodha. He is a professor at University of California in Santa Cruz. Mm-hmm. His research interests include data analytics, visualization, vision, educational innovation. He has more than 20 years of teaching experience and won multiple awards, teaching awards at Berkeley and Santa Cruz. Suresh Lodha got his PhD at Rice University. So please welcome Suresh.
Thank you, Nikolai. So I'm up here to share my experience of teaching an introductory class on computer science to my students at University of California, Santa Cruz. This is joint work with my teaching assistant, who is a graduate student at UC Santa Cruz, Sonali Swamyalipi. And I also want to express my thanks to Siddhant Chandgotia, who helped me put together this presentation. So this is an introductory class in computer science. These students have had no prior computer science background, I will say. It's about 68%. Actually, I think it's reversed. I'm sorry. There is an error in this first slide. There's 68% male and 32% female. The ethnicity breakdown is there. And then this is an introductory class. Mostly freshmen and sophomore, but junior and seniors are also taking it. They are not computer science majors. So in terms of majors, actually, this class is not really meant for computer science majors, for non-majors. So there is a very large component of social sciences students, and as you can see, about 30%, and another 30% who are undeclared. And a much smaller percentage of engineering students, which includes computer science, computer engineering, electrical engineering, and so forth. This is a very large class. It's a public university. This is called a lower division undergraduate class. And so we encourage having a very large number of students. The number of students in my class was 150, but there are other offerings which has as high as 250 students in the class. And this class is required for some majors as a general education requirement. For example, for business and economics majors. So there are students in the class who are taking it just because they have to take it, and it has some implications in terms of their motivational level, et cetera, which I always have to deal. I have taught this class several times, as you will see. There are very, very few students, not negligible, but I think we did a survey, and you know, there are less than 6% students who have had some prior experience, and really about 2% who have had some real prior programming experience. We asked how many times you have coded in 1 month and a week and once and daily, and that number was really small. So this class is not really meant for students who have had some prior programming experience. So that's the background. And so before I get into the class itself, this is a question that we means collectively, we, the colleagues at the computer science department, have been thinking about as to how to really introduce a computer science course for non-majors. And we have had experimentation in teaching an introductory computer science for CS majors, for science majors, for arts majors, for social science majors, and you know, a whole bunch of variety of them. And a lot of questions interface that. So one approach is, you know, we ask ourselves whether we should give high-level expository talks, you know, bringing examples of innovative computer science thinkers, and some people have done that, or whether we should spend more time discussing in-depth certain concepts that students get really well. And the other questions we say always, you know, how much time we should divide between theory and concepts versus really delve them into programming. And a lot of classes really focus on programming and pick a language and focus on that. And then there is this debate that we have to ensure, you know, which programming language we want to choose, you know, whether we use C++, C, processing, Python. And there are a variety of these going on. If you look around at the universities, et cetera, you will find almost all flavors of these kind of programming languages that are offered at various universities. TouchDevelop, of course, is new, which I want to talk about. So which programming languages? And then, of course, this dichotomy between desktop and mobile. So this is the first time I taught a course, an introductory computer science course, using a mobile platform, as I will share with you. But many of those, or most of those, to the best of my knowledge, introductory computer science courses are almost inevitably always taught using a desktop. And there is also this background of which I will not speak much about in this presentation, but I will be happy to engage with you offline. There is this thrust, as you must be aware, by Janet Wing on computational thinking. So we also think about, you know, what is the really content of this introductory computer science class? What is it that we are really training them towards? You know, is there some meaning to trying to inculcate computational thinking? So some of that has influenced the concepts and the content of the course that I have taught for the first, you know, for the first time using this mobile approach. And there is this parallel effort, as you may also be aware, is the by College Board and several leading computer science thinkers all over, is whether we should be teaching a course on CS or CS principles course, which is really focusing on inculcating computational thinking or some components of it. And of course, there's a debate going on what is really meant by computational thinking and what are various components of it. and College Board has been involved in developing a CS principles course, an AP course on that, and NSF had funded 5 centers, one of them being University of Washington, Seattle, right here, another at UC Berkeley, and there are several other centers, and I will mention that briefly. So the whole philosophy, you know, we've been thinking about this, and also, you know, what type of applications we should be emphasizing for the kind of learners that we are getting, who are much more mobile savvy and much more computer savvy than, let's say, even 3 to 4 years ago. So robotics or data visualization, graphics, animation, or, you know, Ashoka's social entrepreneurship, which is another one of my passion. So with all this background, there has been courses that has been taught. So this course has been actually usually offloaded in the last 5 to 10 years, if you browse the website, by a lecturer, Patrick Tantalo, who uses or delivers what I will call the boilerplate course, which is a textbook style. You can find several textbooks on Amazon. If you do Introduction to Computer Science, there is a link to that. You know, there is an Invitation to Computer Science, which has pretty much similar contents, hardware, software, some programming languages, etc. You can browse through his websites, very, very similar content in the last 7 to 8 years that he has taught the class. And then for the first time, Jim Whitehead, who is the chair of the department, taught this class. You can find that content also recently, about a year ago. And he focused more on high-level expository talks. And although he does emphasize a few, he did give a few programming exercises, but he didn't emphasize it very much. And you can see his emphasis was on high-level expository talks. And then last quarter, Madeline Walker taught this class. And she taught it using processing language. And she followed, pretty much influenced by Larry Snyder's course. And, you know, Larry Snyder is one of the champions of the one of the 5 centers that I just mentioned, emphasizing APCS principles. And she taught it just last quarter. So where does the course that I taught just last quarter, just finished from March to objective? So my objective was to make CS fun and interesting. And really, I'm focused on trying to influence them to think about how computer science has been used to solve problems of importance to society. And it amazes me, there are these high school kids which come from freshmen and so forth, they haven't heard about crowdsourcing and computing. It's absolutely human computation. They have no clue about it. And you know, they're involved in Facebook and Twitter, et cetera, but they have very little understanding of machine learning and all these things. Their exposure is really, really poor. And they don't know that all these entrepreneurs are coming and solving computer science, using computer science to solve problems of society. So I wanted to emphasize that. And certainly they are very, very interested in expressing themselves using computer science. They have these mobile phones with themselves and they want to do something with it useful. So that was my course objective. And the question is, how did it color my objective? So last summer, with a much smaller class of only about 35 students, I tried an experimentation of combining C++ with a little bit of a Scratch. Which Dan Garcia has used. He's a lecturer at University of California, Berkeley, and also one of the 5 centers of AP computer science principles. They use Scratch, or they introduce Scratch, but they quickly also move into Byob, B-Y-O-B, and they also use a lot of high-level expository talks because they find that the Scratch is not sufficiently in-depth to introduce more, I would say, complicated programming concepts. So I had all these thoughts in the background when I decided to offer this class. And so these are the 3 things that I had a conscious pedagogical intervention that I wanted to allow students flexibility to choose between various options. So between Scratch and TouchDevelop and many different types of things that they can do within the classroom environment. And I won't be able to go into details of all of them, but you will see some flavor of what kind of flexibility I allowed. And it created both learning and evaluation challenges, particularly because there are 150 students. And we conducted a pre-course survey and a post-course survey. Some examples of that you saw, but many of these will be coming out in a future paper. So one of the things in innovative contribution, you know, I said that you have to tell. So one of the things I emphasized at the very beginning is why computer science matters, because I wanted to actually give them the, you know, importance of computer science. And the 3 medium that I introduced and I encouraged them to do is, one is Twine. How many of you are familiar with Twine? Nobody. Okay, great. So Twine is just an interactive storytelling platform. It's very easy. You can learn it in a couple of minutes. It's very easy for introduction to computer science. It's a free open source software. You can just download it, and you can create, build some narratives, not rich narratives that you'll see in demo feast tomorrow. But you can quickly build a story, an interactive branching story. It's a tool that is used by computer gaming design people as well. And then I had this choice between Scratch and TouchDevelop. And Scratch, I already had some experience. So you know, Nikolai, Pelli, Armand, they were very helpful in giving us actually a lot of phones in Touch Windows Phone. So we had those phones, and we wanted to decide how many students to give Scratch and TouchDevelop. Eventually, it landed up that about 20 students were using TouchDevelop, and about 120 students were using Scratch. So I was kind of learning two types of parallel programming experience to students, but the concepts were similar, so it did work out. So I'm going to go through the course overview somewhat quickly, because in terms of the content, you know, you could say that it's problem solving, it's history of computer science, learning pseudocode, and the TouchDevelop language features that Nikolai mentioned, you know, what's a script, lots of actions, data, local and global variables, types. There is a concept of number maps, which is like graphs, control flow, input, output. But the big thing is really sensors. Sensors is what made the mobile experience much more different. So sensors and the events, the phone shake events, et cetera, and things like that. So I want to directly actually soak you in into the process. So I'm going to take you to this branch of TouchDevelop that I used in the class rather than the other branches. And then I'll come back towards the end, and I will discuss the other experiences. So it is a 10-week course. And so I give three programming assignments. The first programming assignment, which I will not demonstrate, is very simple. It's basically an introductory assignment. And they use a camera, and they use text-to-speech. So you can use a camera, you can text-to-speech. You will say, hello, Suresh, how are you doing today? They take a picture of yourself or a friend of them and then post it on the wall, which is on the screen. The second programming assignment, which you see on the right, is a graph. And the students can walk with the phone, and they can measure their GPS location, and they can find their initial point, they can find their end point, and they can draw a graph, which is what they call in TouchDevelop a number map. So you will get some graph, which you see on the far right end. And you can use it also a pedometer, so you can use an accelerometer, which case in case you walk, your phone gets some kind of jerks, and it finds out how many steps you have taken. If you have calibrated your steps, you can also find how much distance you have used. So you can use either of those methods, and you can even compare them using either GPS or an accelerometer. Some part of that code is already provided in the TouchDevelop book. So partly we were motivated to use something that they will not feel really intimidated about. This third one is really fabulous. When I gave all this program, I wasn't really sure how this will work out. It has worked out extremely well. So third program was really using the game board API, and you probably are not necessarily familiar with API, but it allows dragging, swiping, tapping on the mobile phone. So it was a much, much harder level of challenge than the first two assignments. And so I was skeptical, but apparently I'm very pleased with the results, as you will begin to see. So what I'm going to now sort of delve into is to actually begin to show you some of the final TouchDevelop projects that came out from these 20 students. And these are just the images associated with them, but I'm going to show you some of these. So I'm going to start with the second one. The first one runs into some TouchDevelop challenges that I will mention later. So I'm going to start with the one on the right. So this is a group of two students, Christopher Mimilis and Nicholas Dow, and they developed an English-Japanese audio-visual flashcards. And so I'm going to switch to that. And let's see, hopefully everything will work seamlessly if luck favors me. I mean, all these technical devices, you're never sure. Okay, good. So this is, I have to go back, go to installed, and go to this Nicholas Dow program. There's a little bit of a time lag, not too much today, very good. So we execute this, that's right. So this is Easy Nihongo. I don't know any Japanese. If there's anybody who knows Japanese, will probably understand more than me. So we tap for a word, I tapped, okay. Okay, I have to increase the volume. Let me see if that works. Okay. So you tap a word, and this, OK. Can you hear it? Good. So that was one of the final projects that came out of this class, English-Japanese vocabulary. Let me revert to my second program here that I want to show. Okay. Let me show this fisherman program. Actually, this was the program that was designed by my teaching assistant to introduce this assignment before the students actually jumped into this assignment. This was also following the theme of why computer science matters. There is this PhD thesis that came out from Cornell University about Kerala fishermen, that they were using cell phones to increase their economic productivity, that they will go out into the ocean, the fishermen, and when they're coming back, in the olden days, they will just come to their village and try to sell their fish, and they will get whatever prices they can. But nowadays, they have cell phones, those of them. And then when they're coming in, they will call, and they will find out which market has the best value for their fish, and they will go to that particular market and get much better value. So this is a part of this. So Sonali developed this code. And what you see over here is two fish market, one on the left, one on the right. And there's a lot of this money, and you will see, let's see what happens. Yeah, this fisherman comes, and he goes to the ocean to fish. And I'm tilting the phone, which you cannot see. You can see only. And then if he goes to this market, the one on the left, so this is dragging, tapping, and sliding, then when he comes out of it, he has caught a lot of fish, but let's see, get some money. Let's see. And he goes to this right market. It's a little bit sensitive. Okay, he gets lots of fish and lots of money appearing. And the real thing is that, let's see, if I can make this guy touch the tower. So he calls before he comes in, actually. Let's see. It's a little challenging once in a while. Yeah, I think I'll give up right now. So if he touches the tower, you know, the cell phone's supposed to ring, and that's how this person gets the information as to which of the two places he needs to go to. Yeah, so I'll give up on that one right now. These are developed by students, so they're a little bit better than me in demonstrating these. This is a second group. So this is the second final project. The one that I showed by Sonali was by teaching assistant. So this is a dragon game. So this is by Christian Lopez Pena. He developed this program all by himself. And this is a nice, interesting dragon game. And so there are these three things, which, again, I have to tilt this. And the boy in the middle, I'm bad at this, but I'll try this boy to win, which is hard this time. I'm trying my best to drag this boy to one of these trap doors. And if he does, then a second screen will develop away from the dragons and the trap drawer. Come on, come on. OK, win. So now it's the second screen of the game. He has gone to level 2. I'm not going to try this. I always lose this one. It's a game over. Otherwise, if I drag this boy again to the another trap door, then a level 3 will open up. Amazing. I love this. And so that was the second project that I discussed. Let's see how am I doing with the time, 4 o'clock. I can keep you guys entertained for long. So let's see. So, wait a second. I want to get out of this game. Maybe I'll show you one more, the alarm, which is my favorite. I mean, I like all of them, a lot of them. Okay, this is Dragon Game. I go back. These students all got A+. This is the A5 alarm. They're all designed by themselves. No, you know, I give them a lot of flexibility to decide what they want to do. And so this is the alarm game. Come on. Okay, alarm, good, wonderful. So let's see, hopefully it works. It becomes too loud, I will have to. So this is an alarm. You will see in a minute how it works. I put just 3 maybe here. Go, minute, you wanna wake up at 58? Go. Okay, so now, it's not too loud. So this alarm wakes you up at 3:58, if that's when you wanna wake up. And I'm actually tilting this phone, and there's a maze that you have to solve in order to shut down the alarm. So this boy is traveling through this maze while you listen to all this music. Make sure you're awake. And finally, there's boy. Ah, there you go. You're awake. You turned off the alarm. Great, wonderful. Yes.
Is it possible you could just quickly show the code of that wonderful example?
Code for that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I can share that with you later. I will have a little bit of challenge in. So, is it published? Is it? Yeah, I think it's published. Yeah. Right now?
Interesting to see.
Yes, certainly interesting.
Just interesting to see the code.
Yeah, sure, sure. Here's the code.
There we go. Right.
Here's we go to code. Yeah. And yeah, there's the code. There it is. Yep. Okay, let's get back to, maybe I'll show you one more program. I like a lot of them. So this is the Sungyung-jin programs, which I show for two reasons. It's actually a very beautiful story, and it is an audiovisual story. It also ties to the theme of why computer science matters. And unfortunately, we encountered several difficulties with text-to-speech API in TouchDevelop. It works sometimes, it doesn't work sometimes. It has worked many times, but today it was not working. Also Windows, I think the website was down. So we have disabled the speech part, which is actually half of the story. That's real fun. But so I'm going to run it without the speech, which would have played. So I'm going to speak in terms of the story. So what if you're lost in forest? This is a story developed by Sungyung-jin. So I'm just tapping it. So there are these kids in the car, and they drive, and then they drive, and they get lost in this forest. This guy designed all this artwork just by himself. And this is their house. They went, and the way they lost in the forest is they were playing, and they probably kicked the ball down. I'm dragging the ball, you don't see that, with my finger, so it got lost in the forest. And yeah, there's a bulb there, so they click that. And so they find their current location, and I have to do some of these shakings, which I hope I don't do too wildly. And as they're walking, they're trying to find GPS location. I'm going to give you the secret away that they have this dog was lost with them, and this dog has a GPS tracker on him. And that's why they're able to find their location. Let's hope it works. Is it changing the locations? Ah, wonderful, great. And so tap the question mark, and this dog goes towards this light, and then the parents find out where they are, essentially. And because the dog had the GPS, and these kids stopped crying, I guess, because their parents have found them. So all this story is told for them. That's right. So that's the GPS, the dog collar with GPS. That was their audiovisual story on why computer science matters. Great. So that's the delight. So I was very happy. I was a skeptical. I want to say that, you know, well, maybe I will say that a little bit later. Okay, so let me switch back to my presentation. And right, so this is the audiovisual interactive story. This is the Japanese story. This is the interactive alarm on the left. On the right is the dragon game that I shared. One student wrote school bus location notifier app. You know, it will find out where the bus locations are and it will tell you when to get there. Yes, thank you. And then one person developed a, you know, you can shake the phone each time you have a drink and it will find out how many drinks you had and accordingly decide or suggest you whether you should drive or not. And then there was a flood tsunami aid app. And the fisherman's story I already showed to you. So let me move towards teaching challenges that we faced as an early adopter of TouchDevelop. So certainly there is this erratic performance of certain TouchDevelop APIs. Text-to-speech actually gets cut off abruptly. That's why I didn't even show. There is a time lag behavior of sprites with certain events that we experienced. We aren't very sure whether it's phone dependent or is touch develop dependent or is it just some kind of a bug, but shake events require different amount of jerking. Windows phone, we got lots of phones. Some phones we needed to discard because they hung during runtime. And you know, we got different kinds of phones, Samsung Focus 7, and then there were HTCs. Depending on the phone and the touch develop versions, there were some variations in performance which create teaching challenges. There is also this challenge of displaying from the phone to the projector screen, and fortunately we didn't have any problem today, but initially we faced some challenges, so we got an unlocked phone thanks to Pelli and Nikolai and Armand, and so mostly smoothed out. Sometimes there is a time lag. And one of the teaching challenges was about sharing the codes. Some students were working in pairs, some students were working alone, and they wanted to share the code, but they didn't really want to publish it beforehand, but that's not really possible, so that was challenging. Also, if you have local images and sounds, you can run this program, but if you publish it, you have to publish your images and sounds as well. That's a little bit painful. And the displayed code on the local phone doesn't really match with the web code. So there are all these challenges. And then there are certain Wi-Fis. So Santa Cruz, UC Santa Cruz has different Wi-Fis. Some Wi-Fis work well, some Wi-Fis actually block certain APIs. And we didn't realize that. And certainly Christopher also mentioned that if you write a large code or a large number of options, then you know that's a problem on any mobile platform that hasn't anything to do with TouchDevelop. So this, we also conducted some post-course survey on TouchDevelop and other things. So you should really read as likelihood of recommending TouchDevelop in future. So apologize for this mistake. It's not likely of adopting, but likely of recommending. So the question was, are you likely to recommend TouchDevelop in future to your fellow pairs? And as you can see, I'm surprised pleasantly. There's only 20, it's a small sample of 20 students, but you know, seven students said that they are high, you know, somewhat likely, and the rest are sort of equally divided among highly unlikely, unlikely, neutral, and highly likely. So somewhat favorable results, I would say. And what students liked about TouchDevelop is, you know, user interface and code suggestions. That was Christopher was mentioning, that you get all those prompts, so it's very easy for you to code. Certainly fun with sensors that we all know, and you know, instant compilation and instant running on phone. Corrective suggestions and error detection, some debugging things are also very good, and ready to use auctions and services. You know, users' documentation could be improved, but some of these things that I already mentioned, erratic physics and difficulty in assigning, and certainly it has a steeper learning curve than Scratch. So these students were interacting with these other fellow peers, and they were saying how it compares with the Scratch, et cetera. So I'm running out of time, but I just want to say that there were additional things that we are focused on. So students actually prepared, each student in a pair or certain, they actually prepared as to why computer science matters. So this is like a PPT slide that they presented. So Shady Nimri is a student who said why computer science matters. So these are five topics, M finders. They had a video and, you know, link to a video, a link to a website. They're doing internet search. They get a lot of exposure on why computer science matters. Then I also assigned by choice, they were not doing all of them, conceptual projects. So some of them were discussed inspiring innovators. Some of them said, you know, why online CS courses, et cetera. And this is really beautiful. Some of them developed interactive story using Twine, which you're not familiar with, but they developed a story on Twine. And this story is about a moral compass. You know, some crime has been committed. You can click, you can develop the story. This person is caught. And several years later, they find there is a hearing because some things have been embedded in their brains, which are computers, they are judges. It's amazing how far students can go when they're given all this flexibility to express themselves. So I'll be happy to share these stories with you, maybe offline. I'm just going to quit. There are about 10 stories. I included three, but of course that would be a much longer talk. So let me see. I just don't want to disconnect myself here. So I go to present. Okay. And there were a lot of final programming projects in Scratch. That was the bulk with 120 students. What you see at the bottom was part of the post-course survey that we asked that, are you likely to take more CS classes in future or same CS classes in future or less computer science classes in future? And 33% of them said they would like to take more CS classes, 45% same, and less 21%. So these are some Scratch final projects images. One of them, the first one, is about family vacation, which I will not present because I've run out of time. But it's also an interactive branching story, which tells, you know, what happens in a family vacation and the GPS, and it's beautiful. Students experience touch, develop, and Scratch. Scratch is easier, but it's also more limited, but it provides an excellent platform for expressive storytelling and game design, but touch, develop is much more versatile. So I'm just going to wrap up with future work. And so I want to do interactive storytelling with Twine. We want to write a paper. We want to do more with social media applications. And this is introductory CS. We have a mobile application classes, which teaches uses Android platform and IDE platforms to teach them mobile applications. So I will wrap up. Thanks very much to Nikolai, Pelle, and Armand, and also Kent, I don't know if he's here, to give us give us not just the phones, but also provide constant network in order for us to teach this class. And thanks to the team at UC Santa Cruz, some faculty colleagues, and there's a large number of undergraduate students on the right who helped make this work with a very large number of students. So thank you very much.
Thank you.